yet it can be. When the guns are still.
Ours commemorates the Battle of Beaumont-Hamel and the Royal Newfoundland Regiment. Robert and John, the librettist and composer, join me today. How are you guys doing?
Fine, thank you. How are you?
I'm fine. Happy to be here. Thank you.
So glad you're here. How did opera start in your lives?
You probably have the longest answer.
You have the shortest answer.
I have the shortest answer. Opera started in my life. I was sitting at home one day, minding my own business as a humble playwright in St. John's, Newfoundland, and I got a call from Cheryl Hickman, the artistic director of Opera in the Avalon, asking me if I would write the libretto for this piece. I am a newbie to this world. This is my very
Welcome.
First piece. Thank you. But I had the great fortune of working with this gentleman who is not only, I'm going to butter you up now, not only immensely talented, but immensely generous and kind and patient. And I learned so much from working with him. It was sheer joy.
Thank you. I guess my opera career started in 2001 when I was commissioned to write my first opera. And I've written, this is my fourth one. So I've been doing this for a while, and prior to that, I'm not a singer, but I've loved going to opera and listening to opera, and you know, they're putting it on as a soundtrack as while I'm working or doing something, and just listening to the beautiful voices and a wonderful story and the orchestrations, and that's something that I just am. I mean, it's got me. It's inside of me.
Do you remember the first opera that you heard or saw that first made you think, wow, I could be a part of this?
Well, yeah, I think the first opera I saw was the Canadian Opera Company in Toronto doing La Traviata back in 1985, maybe 1986. I was a kid, but I loved it. It was big sets and big singing and a full orchestra, and it was just high emotions. It was gorgeous. It was beautiful, and I just wanted to be part of that world.
So tell us about Beaumont-Hamel and the story that ours tells.
Sure. Beaumont-Hamel is kind of it's a scar. It's any way to put it. It's a scar on the legacy of Newfoundland and Labrador as a province, but certainly as a country before that.
Men unmade by what they've seen. Not these men. Not these men.
And a lot of people outside of Newfoundland don't readily know that July 1st, which of course is Canada Day, is also Memorial Day in Newfoundland. It was the first day of the Battle of the Somme in 1916, so this year is actually the 100th anniversary, hence the opera. And on that day, the Newfoundland Regiment was one of several regiments that went up and over the top at a little town called Beaumont-Hamel, which was dug in. Both sides were dug in, and something fierce was going to happen. And the 800 members of the Newfoundland Regiment went up and over to the top, and 86 answered the roll call the next day. So it was a complete disaster. Many historians will say an entire generation of young Newfoundlanders were wiped out. And it really changed and shaped the future of the country. It not only took out some of the best and brightest minds, because that's who was being sent to fight. They were the privileged. They were the wealthy merchants' kids. They were, you know, really great, up-and-coming, wonderful people. Not only were they taken out, but it also shaped the economic future of Newfoundland. Our war debt was essentially what put us into bankruptcy and what led to the loss of our nation. So Beaumont-Hamel as an event is complex, and it's a scar, and it's going to be a really interesting year to see people looking at it, not only through the eyes of this opera, but looking at that event and trying to make sense of it.
Yeah. How much of this work is fiction and how much of this work is true fact?
Wow, a lot of it is fact. A lot of it surrounding Nangle is fact. Certainly the details, moment to moment, beat by beat in the show, are based on factual record. One of the things that I made the decision of, and I think John supported me greatly on this, was when we were going in and building a story around Thomas Nangle to, you know, have it dramatically cohesive, building a story around him that involved telling the stories of soldiers, it became very apparent to me right away, out of respect, that if I couldn't find the appropriate story in the actual record, that I was completely going to make it up, that I was not going to create a fictional story and tag it to the name of someone who had actually passed away, because, you know, these families, you know, their grandkids, their great-grandkids are coming
absolutely
to see this.
Yeah, absolutely.
So there are a series of characters in the show who are completely fictional, but the situations that Nangle finds himself in terms of integrating with these people are completely factual.
You know, sometimes it's easier to write fiction than it is to write historical fact. What do you think the hardest part about writing this work was?
I think probably based on what we were talking about, is being correct as we can and as respectful as we can to the characters who we depict in the story. Obviously, you want to get it right, but you know we have 120 minutes to tell a story that it sprawls over decades, and so inevitably you have to make cuts and you have to focus on key elements, and so you're always going to miss something, right? And if people know certain details, private details about characters, well, we don't know those details. Yeah. It's not going to be on stage, right? So that's always hard when you have to pare everything down so that we can tell a story efficiently and hit all the big points, but not get into the minutia.
The silence, or how soundly they all sleep, this cold.
It was also really important to it was, you know, interesting because myself and John didn't know each other before this process. And so we were kind of introduced almost like a Skype blind date by Cheryl.
Blind date, yeah.
and you know, it was two of us kind of trying to feel each other out what it was going to be. And one of the things we first actually agreed upon, and I remember going, okay, he may actually choose me to do this project, was when I said, I have no interest in actually telling the story of the battle. I have no interest in actually doing a historical reenactment of the Battle of Beaumont-Hamel. I was more interested in, because that's been done 100 different ways, and it's a part of the historical record. I was more interested in digging into the aftermath and the scars, I say, not only on Nangle, but also on the entire country. And when I said that, I think John kind of had this little nod on the other end of the Skype, and we kind of agreed on that.
Well, a recreation of a battle is great for film. We can take it the next step. You know, we can get personal, we can get inside people's minds through and connect vocally to what they're thinking and present emotions on stage. If you want a blockbuster spectacle, I mean, that's for the films, right? And we don't have those sorts of budgets. We can't do that on stage. We can't do that well.
And, you know, have you had anybody who is a relative of or had a relationship with these people in these stories come to you and have an opinion or have something to say?
My previous operas have always been based on factual events as well and real people. And I'm always surprised by the phone calls I get suddenly the day after we open with these tidbits, little morsels of information that we didn't know. But you know, it's too late when the piece is done. You know, and I just hope we're faithful to the story and to the characters and to the individual people.
Yeah, to echo what John said, I think we're going to have our ears talked off the night of opening with
you
people.
You seem ready for it.
Yeah. I look forward to it. It's always a really gratifying part of the process. I think telling true stories is having someone come up and go, well, that's my great uncle, or it's always amazing.
So we have a question from you from Tim Brady, who is the composer of Six Revolutions, who's also part of this. And his question for you is this.
Hi, I'm Tim Brady, composer of Six Revolutions. My question is, when writing a work on the events of World War I, how do you balance the tragic and heroic personal stories without romanticizing the political actions of the larger military-industrial complex that drove millions of men to their deaths for no apparent reason other than money and power?
I love that question.
Then you take it.
I love that question. I mean, I don't know if I have an answer for it, but I will tell you this. I actually had a kind of rambling argument one night at a perfectly nice dinner party, went down the tubes because I wouldn't shut my mouth.
Good job, Robert.
About Beaumont-Hamel. It was a couple of days after July 1st, and I was at this dinner party, and a couple of people at the dinner table were having that exact opinion of to even commemorate war or is to celebrate it. And I have the exact opposite opinion. Every time I go to the War Memorial, and I go quite often for these ceremonies, every time I go, I see so many pacifists. It's incredible. You know, again, to go back to what the point of the opera was for me, it was always not to reenact this battle where these brave men. It wasn't about that. It was about an event that was a tragedy and that left a scar. And part of that scar is that I think, and I hope it comes out in the show, part of that scar is that these men were going off to fight for king and country. They were going off for glory, and they literally end up as bodies in the dirt in the show. So there's hardly any glorification in that.
What do you want people to leave this show thinking about or feeling?
One of the things that I'd like to take away, or people to take away from this, is that this event happened, and that these things happen, and that these things can still happen. And they're happening today. where, not to this huge scale, but there's this needless battle, needless loss of life. And why are we still doing this 100 years later?
I wish you guys the best of luck. I'm very excited to see it travel Canada, travel the world. Thank you guys so much for stopping by and having a chat with me.
Thank you, Zach.
Really appreciate it.
How much does it take to break a man? 2 long years in the front, 100's gone in half an hour.